So thanks again, Thomas, and also all the organizers for inviting me. Today, I have the pleasure of talking about a work that I've done in collaboration with Thomas and also Silvio Franz. So I will just go straight into the definition of the model. So the model is, the problem is studying, processing, developing on networks. It's more about dynamical processes on networks for this talk, but I want to guide you step by step. So I will start with a static problem on a network, and I will consider a particular application, a model that is called stochastic block model. So the problem is the following. You have a network, so you have a set of nodes, the red markers here, and a set of edges connecting them. So every time you see an edge between two nodes, there is an interaction going on. Furthermore, we add a variable to each node. In this case, I called it sigma. You can see it as a spin if you want, but it could be anything related to the node, what the node means in your problem. In this case, I assume that this variable can take one among three values, categorical values, so either blue, red, or green, three colors. And the point of the stochastic block model and this type of models that I'm interested in is that this variable tells you something about the structure that you observe. So in other words, knowing what the color is of each node tells you, allows you to predict the probability that two nodes interact. So it tells you the probability that you observe this exact same set of edges that we see here. So usually we don't see the colors, we only see the edges, but we want to find the colors because this tells us about the mechanism of the network we observe. So the mechanism with which we see the edges forming against two nodes. So in this particular example, I picked it on purpose because I think you can already perceive just by looking at this image that there is some clustering going on. So in other words, if you assign colors to nodes and you assume that there is a higher probability for nodes with the same color to interact, you can perceive that there are three clusters. So the goal of this type of model is to find the set of colors, so to the set of blue, green, and red for each node that makes the graph that you observe here more likely to exist.
Okay, so I'm confused.
Yes.
I just see red nodes.
Exactly. So that was just like the intuition, more like a qualitative explanation. But I frame it with math now by telling you that we are going to take a probabilistic approach. So an approach where we assume that there is a probability of observing a certain variable. For instance, there is a probability of observing a node being equal to blue. And that's given by this, I don't know if you can see my cursor here, my mouse, but there is this probability distribution that depends on the interaction between the nodes. So in other words, here is nothing but a Bernoulli distribution that tells me whether an edge exists or not. And this depends on the color in the nodes. So this C is a matrix. And tells me that if two colors have the same, if two nodes have the same color, so if the sigma and the sigma g are equal, let's suppose that this C matrix is very high, has very high entry in the diagonals and very small entry in the off diagonals. So that means that you have a higher probability because the Bernoulli is parametrized by the probability that you see here. So this the entry, the diagonal entry in this case of C, it will have higher probability of exist than an edge between two nodes that are have different colors. So this is what I meant, that if you observe the color, you can give an estimate of the probability of observing an edge. And let's take this particular example where we assume that the C here is mostly diagonal. This is basically telling me that there is a higher likelihood of observing an edge between two blues or two reds than one that an edge between a blue and a red, basically. this one here, this gamma, is just a prior probability of belonging, of having a certain color. And it's just a factorized distribution. So this one here is nothing but the posterior in probability. It's basically using Bayes' theorem. This part here is the likelihood, and this is the prior. So you get the posterior distribution of the variable color on nodes. The main assumption behind this model is that you use these variables, this sigma, that you don't observe, but you connect them to the probability of observing an edge. For instance, in this particular case, with a Bernoulli distribution. So
Gero had a question about the graph, whether it's a random graph.
Sorry, I could. Yes, this is a random graph, but the point is, I'm not seeing the chat, but yeah, thank you for. So yes, it's a random graph, and the probability with to observe this particular graph is the one is not all of this, because this is the posterior sigma, but this part here, the product over I less than j, is the likelihood of observing that graph given the sigmas. So yes, it's a random graph, but with this particular probability structure, and this is the basic stochastic block model. So the stochastic block model, because basically you observe blocks, the clusters, everyone blue, everyone red, and this determines the probability of the edges. So this might seem a bit obscure, but if I write it in another way, maybe some of you will be more familiar with it, because I just rewrote it in the shape of a Boltzmann distribution. So it may resemble a little bit more like an Ising model, with the exception that is a bit more complicated, because you don't have a standard Jij, sigma I, and sigma j, but you have a logarithm of a matrix calculated in sigma I and sigma j. So it's a little bit more complicated, but nevertheless, the model is a pretty standard model. There are very efficient way to solve it. So what does it mean to solve it? Solve it means maximizing this posterior probability on the sigma. So to find the maximum over all the configurational of colors that maximizes this, basically. So the output will be a probability over sigmas, and it will be the posterior distribution. So if you run this algorithm, you find that the solution is this one, the solution that maximizes this posterior probability. And this, I think you can perceive, is what you were expected at the beginning, because now you see all of the green dots here. And you see many more connection between green dots than between green and red, or between red and blue, which is what our model was supposed to do. So when you solve this problem, your goal is not just finding this joint posterior probability, but often it boils down to finding marginal probabilities, the marginal of this posterior of over a single variable. So in other words, you want to know the probability that an individual node takes a certain color. Or maybe if you want to go a bit further than that, you want to measure the probability that a pair of nodes gets each one its own color. So what is the problem now to do this? Well, the problem is here, that we start from this joint distribution, the posterior over here, sigma runs over all the n nodes and is parameterized as we saw before. And we want to find a marginal over this whole posterior, over one single node. So to do that, you need to know this partition function. So that's the classical problem in statistical physics. There are many configurations that you have to go through to calculate this. So it's basically computationally not feasible. Thankfully, though, there are ways to make it doable through an approximation. So although the full partition function, you cannot calculate it, you can still calculate a good approximation of the joint and allow you to calculate then your goal. So the marginal distribution over a node, for instance. And one of the most successful methods to reach this goal to approximate this posterior probability is the so-called message passing algorithm that has been developed in several fields. I wrote here the most important works. There has been a work from physicists. In that community, you often hear it as a cavity method. Then also mathematician or pure statistician, belief propagation. But the point is that it's a very good approximation. It gives you an algorithmic implementation that is very efficient to solve this challenging problem of finding marginal distribution for an arbitrarily complex joint distribution. So the way it works is that you write for that particular example I showed you of the stochastic block model, you write an iteration like this one, where you define this function here as messages from node I to node J that represent the beliefs that node I has of its being of color sigma I. And you transmit this message from one neighbor to the other. So you see here that all the neighbors of I except J, so the neighbors K, also transmit to I their own belief of that current state at the moment, so this sigma K. So the way it works, you transmit these beliefs, which are rough approximation of marginal distributions over single variable, and you transmit this in an iterative way until you reach convergence of these messages, basically. So this is a pure algorithmic update, but it has very strong theoretical foundation that tells you that this is a good approximation for the joint partition function. The bottom line is that we solve this problem, we can solve this problem efficiently by reducing an exponential complexity into a polynomial one in the number of variables. So before we had, so the problem was n was too big to find the partition function, but with this algorithm, we can find it a good approximation in polynomial time in the number of variables. So that problem is solved. Now let's go into the dynamical case. So far the problem was static, but let's now see what happens if we let these variables evolving in time. So for simplicity, now we forget about the color for a moment and we think about having each variable taking two values, on or off. And that can change in time based on the state of its neighbors at the previous time step. So in other words, this is how we introduce the dynamic, by allowing this variable to change in time, and the transition probability depends on the state of the neighbors in the network of this particular node. So here you see an example of an epidemic model, which is one of the standard dynamical processing on network, where you can start here on the leftmost figure. We have a reference node, the green node, and then all the other around that nodes are red. So red here means on, so you're activated, whereas the white ones are off, so they are deactivated. So as you see, because the neighbors are all active, that node gets influenced. That remains green right now just for fixing the reference. So that was probably the initial node. And then everyone around gets activated and so on. And as we go through time, so from left to right, you see that more and more nodes get activated because they had surrounding nodes that were also activated. So that's the classic epidemic spreading. And you can parameterize this with a probability a transition matrix, W, that tells the likelihood of a node switching between on and off based on the state of the neighbors. And for our work here, we take the so-called Glauber dynamic. So it's a particular parametrization of this matrix that is very much like an Ising model. So you see we have here a Boltzmann distribution with this particular interaction. So in other words, depending on this interaction Jij and the state of your neighbors, you can either activate or deactivate at every time step. So again, what are we interested in now? We want to answer questions like, is this particular node, the blue one I am pointing out, is it on or is it off at a particular time step? So I can ask that question for any time step. So in principle, I would be interested to have a quantity like this. Again, a marginal probability. So the probability that a particular node at a particular time is activated or not. But to do that, I need the information of the whole join probability, which now is it has this shape, and that's the exact shape. So it's a product over successive time step over the transition probability and the initial time step probability here. So this is our join distribution. And as you can see, this variable here, this sigma bar t, it's a n-t-dimensional vector. So it's a huge vector because there are n variables. Each one has its own history, which is t long. So it's a very complex function to deal with. So again, we want to start with this one because the information we have is the transition matrix that tells us how the dynamic evolves. And we know the initial time step, but we want to have the probability distribution of one particular nodes having one particular color at any time step possibly. So again, we face the same problem as before. We have this exponential complexity in the number of variables. And why not using what we used before, the message passing method? Well, it turns out the message passing still works also in this case. It has this particular shape. So it's very similar to the previous case where we replaced what we had before. We had that C matrix, which was particular for the stochastic block model. Now we replace it with this product over the transition matrices. And here we have again the messages from a neighbor k of I to I of its belief of that variable at the previous time step, given the information it had about sigma I at previous time step. And again, the algorithm works at the same as in the static case. The main difference is that here we have a variable that is a whole time trajectory, whereas before we didn't have time, so it was just a simple variable, not a trajectory. But the algorithm works exactly the same. You start by initializing this function, so these beliefs, these messages, and then you initialize them randomly, and then you let them propagate with this iteration. And then you calculate until you reach convergence, basically. And at convergence, you are able to calculate what you wanted at the beginning. So this quantity here, which is the marginal probability over one particular node, because that comes from just standard textbook about belief propagation or message passing. The marginal probability at the end is basically the same function we had here, with the exception of this product that switches from including everything except one node to including everything. So once you do this, you get automatically, because the way it's built, this algorithm, the marginal probability over nodes. And with that, you can calculate the observables like the mean value, the mean number of infected individuals, for instance, and so on and so forth. So this is what we want to do now. We want to apply this message passing algorithm because again, it's efficient. It can lower the complexity to polynomial in the number of variables. And we are all happy. However, I have to say, while the static message passing has been used successfully to model many applications, ranging from the stochastic block model to, I can say also, there are famous ranking algorithm, TrueSkill, for those of you who are familiar with that. It has not been used as much, actually is not very well known for dynamical processes like this. Although dynamical processes are a relevant application in many contexts, but message passing has been unexplored. So why is that? Well, because we have still this computational bottleneck coming this time from the presence of time. So while message passing was able to successfully tackle the computational complexity in the number of variables, is not able to used like that, as I showed in the previous slide, to solve this fundamental problem that now we have time trajectories. And to deal with that, we have an exponential complexity in time. So that's what made, I think, this formalism unexplored to problems that are relevant and popular. So it's not a simple step from let's do what we were doing in the static and let's apply it in the dynamic, because this is now the problem we have to face, this exponential complexity in time. So with that, I can say there has been some work trying to take advantage of it, because the idea is it's a really powerful message passing. But so it's worth making an effort trying to fix this problem in exponential in time complexity. So there are people having tried that, but usually the approach is to make approximation on the messages themselves. For instance, assuming Markovian approximation, so that the messages do not depend on the old trajectory, but only on the previous time step. But often this leads to poor approximation. So we gain in complexity, we can make it feasible, but at the end, it's not working very well. Other approaches for people that still want to tackle dynamical processing on network is to focus on unidirectional dynamics. So dynamics where the states of a variable, once it changes, once it flips, it cannot go back. So in that case, the computational complexity is reduced to polynomial just by definition, because if you know that if a variable gets infected and it cannot go back to to the previous time step, to the previous state, you only need a finite amount of time step to parameterize this. So you can tackle it because now the computational complexity is polynomial, but that's not due to your method. No, it's not due to any fancy method. It's just that the problem itself is not exponential in time anymore. So these are the two main approaches for people to deal with dynamical processing on network with message passing. So it's quite unsatisfying. So this is what we came up with Thomas and Silvio talking about this problem. The idea was to take advantage of matrix product state, because they seem to solve similar problems, but in very different contexts. So we said, why don't we put together these two types of formalism? The message passing, which allows, which is efficient for the complexity in the number of variables, and the matrix product state that allows us to possibly to control the complexity in time. So if we put these two together, our hope is to decrease the computational time, both in space and in time variable. So this is what we propose. We propose to parameterize these messages, so this mu ij, with this ansatz of products of over matrices. So this is the particular parametrization we propose. And the idea is that you plug this into the message passing iteration, the one we saw before. So all you need to specify is your model via this W, the transition probability, and the initial probability distribution. Once you fix these two, you can apply this for any dynamical processes on a network. And the way the algorithm works is that you initially initialize the initial matrices A, and then you iterate this to get the Bs. And you keep that, and you keep repeating this for every time step. So at convergence, you can calculate the observable that we were interested in, for instance, the marginals over the variables. So we can answer to question like, what is the probability that a given node is active or not at a given time step? Now, what is the catch But so far, we just reparametrized everything. So why should that change the computational complexity? Well, actually, it's not. Like, it's just a reparametrization. So the problem with the computational complexity is still there. We didn't solve that yet. But the catch is that we can make it scalable thanks to this reparametrization, and we can do it in a smart way, because we can take advantage of the singular value decomposition of the matrices and control the dimension of these matrices, which can grow exponentially in time if we don't do anything, and truncate accordingly the individual matrices that make these ansatz, that these matrices that if you take the product over them, you get the messages. So the idea is that... Yes.
Gero had a question in the chat about the B matrices. Why you need these B matrices? So what's the idea of going from A's to B's here in this in the previous slide?
Sorry, here. I think that for these slides, I could have used also the A's, yes, but I think this is more like I could have used also the A's. It was probably to make it more like I used the colors to distinguish them, but just to make sure that you don't confuse what is on the left and what is on the right. So yeah,
well, basically, sort of the A's are the matrices for the previous time step, right?
Exactly. That's otherwise it gets tricky to understand, because you've to find this, to find the B's, you need these A's. But is the B at time t plus one here is not the A at t plus time here. So it's you need this. So you see the blue, you don't see the B. So I should just say the A at t plus one is not the B at T plus one here. You find the B once you iterate over these A's. So this is how it works. That's why I put it with different letters and different color to make sure we separate. Because maybe it's clearer if you just see the message passing algorithm. You have on the right side the messages, and then you iterate. But if you see here we have the messages at t plus one and t. Here you don't see maybe I can go back quickly. Yeah, here you see. Because here we have the messages at t given t minus one, but here we have the messages t minus one given t minus two. So these are not these. So that's why the matrices are different. And I played with A and B and the colors to make sure you don't confuse. So I hope this answered the question. Okay. What we were saying is that the matrices they can still grow arbitrarily big, so keep the computational complexity as it was. But if we truncate them through a singular value decomposition, we can manage to control for their dimension to be small. In other words, to keep the computational complexity small. You can think of the A matrices as the carrier of the information about correlation between variables. So the more correlated the variables are, the bigger the dimension is. But if the variables are not correlated that much, you can cut the A's in a way that it keeps the computational complexity under control. So the way it works is that you define the Frobenius norm. You check the Frobenius norm of the original matrix and the truncated one, and you control that you don't cut too much based on how much you want to preserve of this Frobenius norm. So that allows you to make a truncation that is thoughtful, is not set a priori, but it checks how much information you are losing as it is encoded by the Frobenius norm. So you can either fix the dimension, or you can use this, which probably is smarter again, because you check how much information you're losing in terms of the Frobenius norm. But the point is that this truncation allows you to control for the dimension of the matrices and thus the computational complexity. So an example I have here is for a three regular graph. So it's a regular graph, meaning that every node has exactly three neighbors. So it's very sparse. That's again the Glauber dynamic we saw before with ferromagnetic interaction, but that applies regardless, even for any type of JIJ you want to fix. And here we are studying in the thermodynamical limit, so in the limit that the number of variables goes to infinity. And we see here the evolution in time of the average magnetization. So the average value of sigma I over time, over average taken over all the variables, over all the n variables. So you can see it as, if you want, the expected number of individuals that are infected in a network. And here we fix, if you remember, the transition probability at this temperature parameter here, we fix it to one. And in this particular regime of beta equal to one, the average magnetization goes to one. So we compare against Monte Carlo simulations, which usually, if you have a lot of samples, they tend to the ground truth, basically. But they are much more costly computationally. So you cannot go further than probably a few time step, probably 10, 15 time step. And with the one step mark of approximation, the green one here, which is the one that I was talking about, where the messages, instead of parameterizing over trajectories in time, you assume that they only depend on the previous time step. So it's a very efficient algorithm, but the approximation is bad, as I show you how here. If you notice, they all reach the stationary state correctly. So if you go, the stationary state is this one at magnetization equal to one. They all reach it. You have Monte Carlo at various number of samples, except this one, which is probably too few samples. But also the one step mark of approximation is doing it. But what is important is this region here. So in this region is the out of equilibrium region. So it's the transition to the stationary state that is not captured by the other algorithm. So in other words, having this approximation and controlling the computational complexity allows you to have much better accurate, more accurate approximation of the state of your system at any time step. And you can see it even more if we take another case where beta now is 0.1 quarter. In this case, the magnetization, the stationary state goes to zero. So the average magnetization is zero. And that's a particular example where Monte Carlo is giving bad results because of there are states that when you have small quantities to measure, it's particularly sensitive to that. It cannot really track them down to order of magnitudes of how small that is. Whereas our algorithm, it doesn't suffer of this. And it can find that the magnetization does go to zero. Whereas you see the Monte Carlo here, depending on how many samples, it tends to go further and further down, but then it stays more or less here. The error decays slowly. And you can also see it better here, where I plot here the error that for the Monte Carlo simulation, it stays almost constant, basically, because it decays slowly when the variables are small, the variables to be determined are small. And then if you're interested also to see on a magnetization node by node case, you can see here the behavior at different time steps based on the sensitivity with which you cut the matrices. So the idea is that there is a trade-off. The more you cut, so the more you keep the computational complexity small and so the algorithm fast, the more accuracy you lose. So there are two types of information you can see from this slide. Here we have the magnetization of individual spin given the Monte Carlo, the Monte Carlo simulation. And here is the one from our algorithm. So the points along the diagonal means that we are able to catch to determine the individual values of the variables as the ground truth, where for ground truth here we call the Monte Carlo when we are able to run it. And you see that at initial time step, so when t is equal to 10, so you see the circle marker, everything is basically along the diagonal. So it means that we are doing pretty good. But if you go at further time step, so further away from the beginning, the initial time step, so the more memory you need to keep, so the more time step, the more time trajectory there is in the past to make an estimate, you see that we start to spread far from the diagonal, but for the lower threshold. So L here, the smaller it is, the better the accuracy, the smaller we allow the Frobenius norm to be. So we cut, so the smaller the threshold here, the less thing we cut, the less dimension we cut from the matrix. So you see here that passing from 10 to the minus 3 to 10 to the minus 5, where everything goes back again into the diagonal, shows the trade-off between cutting too much. And we can see those. Yeah.
Sorry, Katarina, we slowly need to wrap up.
Yes.
Time-wise.
Yeah. No. I'm done. And then I can also say that Thomas made a further improvement in a recent paper to make it even more fast, even faster, taking advantage of the structure of the matrices. And then I just conclude, I arrived at the end of the presentation by saying that I have to say that the model gave very good results, but there are still several ways to improve it in terms of the computational complexity. So we made huge improvements in terms of passing from exponential to polynomial, but there are still some issues about, for instance, what I was saying in answering that question, that every time we have to recompute the matrices from the beginning. So my natural question was, is there a way to preserve what we just learned in the previous time step? By previous time step, I mean the iteration time step, so that we don't have to throw away everything and then recalculate from scratch at every time step, because this will save a lot of computational time. But to do that, we need to have a measure of how much information there was in the previous time step. So that might be tricky to measure. Secondly, the computational complexity scales with the number of neighbors of a node, because there is that product, that marginalization in the message passing algorithm. So we gave an example for Z equal to 3 and everything worked perfectly. But there are some networks where you might have very few nodes with very high degree. So these are called hubs, and this might make it impossible to find a solution, because you might just need one node that has degree 100 and you cannot calculate the matrices for that node. So we need to deal with this issue. And finally, how to make the model more flexible, because so far, because of the structure of the matrix product, everything is run in parallel. Like you update all of the nodes in one sweep, but what if things happen sequentially? So if there is one single node that updates and then another one. So I don't know how to do this because of the nature of the matrix products, but that might be a way to make it more flexible. And finally, I just want to conclude also showing what would be the equivalent of the model we saw at the beginning, but for the dynamical case, which nobody has done because it's complex. And I was thinking that's a natural way to use the matrix product approximation, but these are recent advancement for the stochastic block model. So it's still a bit too early, but the idea is that if you replace your transition probability with the stochastic block model one, you can still apply the same reasoning. So with that, I conclude.